And so I drink the drink down. Tastes horrible, man. Tastes horrible. Ugh. I drink the drink down and I lay back and I'm saying, whoo, I'm going to be okay. I'm going to be alive. And as I relax back on the bed, I start to hear my heart in my ear. It's like somebody put my heart in my ear. And I start to hear it beat, boom, 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 boom. And when it did that, I popped out of my body. I just popped out, like as if I would just jump off the couch here. I popped out of my body. And the first thing I said then, I said, I'm out.
I'd like to welcome to the show Dennis Bullock. How you doing, Dennis?
How you doing, Alex? How you doing, man?
I'm good, brother. I'm good. Thank you so much for coming on the show, man, and sharing your remarkable journey with all of us, and hopefully getting a glimpse on some very special things that have happened to you in your life. So, first question I have to ask you is, what was your life like before you had a near-death experience? Were you spiritual? Were you religious? Well, how was it before?
Well, I was raised in a Christian home, but I was not religious at all. Okay, I mean, up until about 12 years old, we did go to Sunday school, to church, you know. Was a Christian background, but it was not like a serious religion background. But that was about it as far as religion goes, you know. I was not a serious, I would say I was Christian, is pretty much was what I believed, but I was not a serious practicing Christian.
Right, you were the like myself, maybe the holiday
What?
Christian, maybe it's Christmas,
Yes.
maybe Christmas
Yes.
Mass, maybe Easter Mass if they
Yes.
pull me.
Exactly. So I mean, I couldn't keep up the rules of the Christian thing and all that stuff. It just was, for me, just a, was a lot of too many question marks, and so I, you know, but
So
I was.
you didn't give a real deep. You didn't go down a deep a rabbit hole or a path to discover or learn more about spirituality or learn more about God. You just had a belief that
Well,
there was something bigger out there.
I did at 14 and 15. I mean,
Okay.
at 14, I have to say, at 14, 13, 14, 15, I was quite serious to find out what's it all about. But the digger, the more I digged into the Christianity. I checked a little bit of Jehovah Witness. I read about the Muslims. I dibbled and dabbled to see what. But for me, it was, I didn't find anything really that said, oh, this is it. And you know, so I kind of, it was a phase I went through, you know. I'd say around 15 to about 16, it was like a real big phase. Even my mother thought, well, maybe he's going to be a priest. I said, no, I was just curious about life, you know. I want to know all these mysteries that everybody seems to hold so strong, and the priest and the pastors and everything is so serious. So when I looked about it, you know, there was a neighbor in my neighborhood when I was a kid, and they were Jehovah's Witness, and the kid needed a blood transfusion, and the parents didn't give it, and the kid died. And for me,
Oh, man.
I thought it didn't make sense. Why would God give you a brain and technology, but you don't use it because it's against God? It just didn't, you know, it just, it's like God says, here's the keys to the car, but don't drive it, you
Right.
know. You know, so it's like, you know, for me, that's why religion started to take a back seat, and I started to not take it so serious as I was when I was 14 and 13. Yeah.
And then life happened.
Well, then girls happened, so
Oh
you know,
man, I know those
the
teenage
chicks
hormones.
happened, and I was like, well, you know, I'm religious, yes, God bless, but look at this, you know, so.
We'll talk about that about 2, 3, 4, 5 decades down the line. Let's have some fun.
Exactly.
So, was your first kind of mystical experience the visitation? You had a visitation from your mother after she passed, correct? Was that the
Yes,
first thing
sir.
that happened?
Well, that's the first, I would say, major thing. Yes.
So what was the first thing that started shaking you're like, wait a minute, what's going on here?
Well, actually, the house we lived in was slightly kind of haunted. And when I say haunted, I mean just strange things would happen, you know. sometimes a door would slam and there's no wind. And it would slam at the moment you approach the door. Stuff like that. Doorknobs would turn by themselves and nobody's behind them. Little things like that. But I was a kid. I was like 11, 12 years old, even 9 years old. And for me, it was just like, it's Casper the Friendly Ghost or whatever. We laughed at it. We didn't take it so, oh my God, it's Poltergeist. You know, we didn't mm-hmm. take it like that. And it wasn't as bad as Poltergeist. Poltergeist was pretty bad, but it was enough little things that would happen that you knew something was a little bit out of the ordinary, but not enough for me to say, I'm curious or going on a quest. I said, oh, the house is a little bit strange sometimes. That was about it.
But you didn't have any abilities to see anything or were experiencing anything out of the ordinary?
No, nothing like that. Not at that point. No.
So then the first major thing that happened was your mother, passing and coming to visit you. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, sure. Well, me and my mom, we were very close. I mean, super, super, super close. I mean, my mother didn't have a job. She used to be a legal secretary, but she had quit her job to marry my father. So she didn't have a job, and her and my father weren't getting along so great. But she saved her money and bought me my first saxophone, because I'm a singer and saxophone player. Mm-hmm. And so she meant the world to me. I mean, it was nothing. My mother was the joy. My father was a Marine. Also, he was a cop. and he was from a military family. Mm-hmm. So everything, he loved me, but he only loved me in a way of duty, I felt. Mm-hmm. Not in a way of, what do you really like or what do you really feel? It was more like, here's what do you want for Christmas? Okay, I got it here. What do you want? It's your birthday here. Bye, that's it. It was very dutiful. Mm-hmm. Where my mother, she was just the joy. She brought the life. She would tell me, hey, did you see the birds in the morning? They're so beautiful. Look, she was the joy. And when she got sick and died, my whole world crashed, because it was like, whoa. It's like somebody turned out the lights in my life. It said, whoa. And when that happened, 2 weeks after she died, I started to drink. She died when I was 29 years old, and I started to drink. And every night I had a routine. I'd go to the bar, drink, and then come back home. I was living in Montreal, Canada at the time. And I come back home to my apartment, come in my room, turn out the lights, sit on the side of my bed and go to cry myself to sleep. Now, I did that for about a week and a half. And this one night I came back ready to do my routine coming from the bar. And I came into my room, turned on my light like I always do, and sat on the side of my bed. And I was going to untie my sneakers at the time. And when I looked down, I saw that there was still light. And I said, that's impossible. I know, I just turned out the light. That's impossible. Now, here's the crazy part. When I looked up in my room, it was like the sun you see in the sky was in my room. It was like a wave of love that I can only describe as when you're in the ocean and the wave comes of water and it's too tall for you and covers your whole body. That's how the water was the love. And it just covered my whole body. And it was so powerful. This love just came out so powerful. And I was just like this in my room, shocked. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. And then out of this sun, which later on I found to be God, came like two other lights, which were more like the size of stars. One was a bigger star than the other, and the other one was a smaller star. And the smaller star, I recognized that it was my mother. Now, how I recognized that it was her was just the feeling of her. I knew that it was her because she was just a light, like a star, like a star coming. And they floated right out to me. And I said, oh, mom, that's you. It's like that over there. It's like that over there. And it was so much love. And you know, when my mom had died, man, I all I know is she was dead. I didn't know where she was. You know, even I had religious upbringing. I didn't believe none of it, really. So I didn't, in my opinion, I didn't know where she was. I just know she was gone. She's somewhere, but she's gone. She's not here. And when I saw her, that, and I saw all this love, and I said, oh, it's like that over there. Because it, man, it felt like I was in Hawaii on vacation, and I'm a billionaire. Mm-hmm. And everything is perfect and everything is wonderful. And I got nothing but love around me. So, and then she started to talk to me. And when she started to talk to me, it's like we're talking now, except instead of seeing someone's mouth move, she was like shooting the conversation into my brain. Mm-hmm. I could hear her like I hear you, mm-hmm. but I could also feel it coming into my body, the conversation. I could literally feel it coming in. And she said, I'm going to tell you a week in advance in the future, so you're going to know that this is real, that this is not an illusion or a fake. This is real. Now, she said, you're going to get a job next week. Now, I was a musician, and I hadn't worked in like 2 or 3 weeks. You know, it was kind of like a dry spell. It wasn't not really that great. She said, you're going to find a job. A job's going to come to you by the next week. And she said, there's going to be a bouncer, a guy there. And she said, he's going to be a homosexual. She said, he's going to be a psychopath. And she said, whatever you do, don't argue with him and don't get into a fight with him. Because my mother knew me. I call it the roaring 20s. I was vigorous. And it was like, and I have nothing against anybody who's gay or lesbian, but if you're homosexual and you know that I'm not, and you come after me, I was going to defend myself, you know? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So she knew that I was, you know, I wasn't looking for trouble, but I could be hot-blooded if it came my way. So she said, whatever you do, don't fight, because she said, she explained it like it's like two possibilities or two timelines. Mm-hmm. She said, the first timeline, he'll kill you. He's going to kill you if you get into a fight with him, if you get into an argument with him. The second timeline, she said, you would kill him, but you would go to jail for the rest of your life. And she said, these two timelines, one of them will happen if you get into an argument with him. Mm-hmm. So I said, no, mom, I'm, I won't get into an argument. I won't. I do exactly what you said, you know. And I was just so happy to see her, man.
Sure.
Whatever you have to say, mom, I'm right there. I do exactly. And she said, the second thing I'm going to tell you is that the girlfriend you have now, I had only been seeing this girl for about maybe a year and a half or something like that. She said she has 3 kids that you don't know about. And she said, she's going to try to have a 4th kid with you. And she said, she's going to try to lie about it. Like, say she's on the pill or say she's, you know, mm-hmm. she's going to try to catch you.
Trap
and
you,
she yeah. said, yeah, trap you. And so she said, be careful about that. And I said, okay, mom. And then she said, the other thing she said was that I'm going to be around you always, but you're not going to be aware of me as much as you are tonight. And then she stopped for a minute talking, and then I said, but mom, who's this other light? Because this was this tall light that was standing right next to her. I said, mom, who's this other light? And then the light spoke to me, and it said, I'm an escort. And it said, I'm escorting your mother to the earth. And the exact words, it said, this is an interruption in your life. And then I said, okay, well, interruption. Okay, well, listen, I have some questions here. You know, I say, I got God in my room right now. I want to know. So I want to know who's going to be my wife, how many kids I'm going to have, why am I here? You know, and the angels answered very calmly, very easy. He says, it says, I'm going to tell you all of that, all the answers, but you won't be allowed to remember.
Right.
So it told me all the answers, but I was only allowed to remember what my mother said. So my mother told me she loved me and she would always be around me. And then they floated and they started to melt. Like, it's like if you have a glass, an ice cube in a glass, and it just starts to melt. That's how they went back to the big light and they floated away, and everything just, it started getting dimmer and going back to the room being dark. And when they left, tears just burst out my eyes, man.
Sure.
Because I said, nobody's going to believe me. Nobody's going to believe this happened. Nobody's going to believe this happened. It's so incredible. I said, sure, nobody's going to believe this happened. Right. But I got the proof. The next day after that, I got a phone call from my band. And they said, hey, man, we got a job. Just like my mother said. Now, I didn't dare tell my band what had happened the nights before, because I didn't want them to say, you know, he's a great singer, great saxophone player, man, but he lost it since his mother died, you know. So I said, I'm not telling them nothing about this. So I said, oh, that's great. And my alert inside, I said, oh, wow, everything's starting to happen like she said. Mm-hmm. So I said, okay. So the following days after that, we had to go and do a sound check. And so we went to the sound check, and we went to this sound check. There was this guy at the door, huge. Now, I'm a pretty big guy, but this guy made me, one of his arms was my whole body. He was huge. Like, you know, the Hulk Hogan wrestling style. Type of people. And so he was there, but we came in, we did our sound check, nothing happened. He was cool. He didn't say nothing to me. So then we came back for the gig. Now, we did the first set. Okay, I came in the club, we did the first set, it was great. And I was we were on the break, and I was talking to the band, like the band was here and I was here, and we were talking. And this bouncer, this huge bouncer, walked behind me like that, and grabbed my butt, just like, you know, just grabbed my butt. And I went, hey, you know, but my band, they didn't really see that because he was right behind me. I was standing.
Yeah.
So you couldn't see that he was grabbing me. You just seen him passing me, but you didn't see the grab. But I felt the grab, and I said, hey, I got to tell this guy something. Did y'all guys see that? He said, no. He said, this guy just grabbed my butt, man. I got to tell this guy something. And I was mad, you know, but then I said, oh yeah, remember mom. Don't lose it, man. Just go over there and tell him you're not like that. So I went over there and I said, hey man, I just want to tell you, I'm not like that. Don't touch me anymore. He said, man, you had too much to drink. I didn't touch you. I said, yeah, you did. And I said, just don't do it, man. I'm not like that. Don't touch me anymore. And then he said, well, why did you tell your friends that I touched you? And I said, I told my friends because you did touch me. And I said, I'm not like that. So please don't touch me. Thank you. And I just walked away because I knew that the conversation was, the more I stayed there, was going to the path what my mom was talking about. So I didn't. I walked away. That's it. Because I knew where, if I continued that conversation, where it was going. So I just walked away. And I did the second set. We left the club, and that was it. Next day, band member calls me, says, hey man, did you hear what happened? I said, no, what happened? Remember that bouncer you were talking about? I said, yeah. He got into an argument with the club owner and crushed both of his rib cages and went to jail for manslaughter. He's in jail now.
Oh, the owner died?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
Wow. Crush both of his. Now, you know how strong you have to be to crush a man's, both a man's rib cages.
I mean, you got to be, yeah, that's a mess.
Yeah, so he, but he had to be, he's psycho. Because, and the sad thing is, I knew the owner because he was a friend of mine and he was cool people. So I said, oh my God. Thanks for telling me, man. I didn't tell him anything else. I said, oh my God, everything my mom is saying is coming true. Mm. I said, if that's true, then I have to call my girlfriend. Then what she says about her is true.
Yeah.
So I pick up the phone. I call my girlfriend and I say, hello. She said, hello. Yeah. I said, hey, tell me something. I said, just tell me the truth. It's okay. Do you have three kids? And the phone went silent. And then she said, who told you? And I couldn't believe my ears. I know this girl for so long. I said, wait a minute. I'm going to ask you again. It can't be. Do you have three kids? She said, yes, I have three kids. I said, who told you? And I said, well, I'm going to tell you who told me. My dead mother told me. And I said, me and you finish. Because if you're going to deny your kids, I don't know what else you might be hiding.
Wow.
So we're finished. So then I hung up the phone and my mind was blown. And then I knew I had the proof. And that guy is still in jail to this day. So,
Wow, that's amazing. That's amazing.
So, and that was
that was your first spiritual transforming. It was a spiritual transforming event or something along those
lines. Yes, exactly. So
then let's get into this near-death experience. If that was the appetizer for the near-death experience. So tell me about what happened on your near-death experience.
Well, the thing is, after that first experience, it was so powerful and so much that I tried, as a young man, I tried to say, okay, that's so over the top. Nobody's going to believe me anyway if I tell them. So I said, I'm going to put that aside and try to go back to normal life.
Right.
Let's just try to go back to normal life. So that's what I did. And I was following this guy who was one of the lead singers of the Platters, of the renewed Platters, not the original, but the renewed, because that's old group past my age, but it's a renewed guy, Platters. And he had record deals. He had, everywhere in Germany, America, here, he had success and he could sing his butt off, killer vocals. And so I was following him until one night he introduced me to drugs, and I start taking drugs with him, something I'm not so proud of.
Sure.
And I was following him. He was like my mentor. I thought, hey, he's got success. This must be the way, I want success too. So, when he offered me drugs, I start taking drugs with him. And then he died. I did his last show and he died. And when he died, that was like a wake up call for me. I said, that's it. So I stopped. I stopped cold turkey, no drugs, no nothing. But I replaced it. And what I replaced it with was marijuana.
Mm-hmm.
So I decided, instead of doing the, real hard drugs, I'm going to do a little marijuana. And that's it. Smoke a joint every now and then. It's okay. So that's what I was doing, and with my new girlfriend at that time. And one night, we ran out of marijuana. We just didn't have any that day. So sadly to say, but this is not no push against musicians, but most musicians know where to get marijuana.
This is not news, sir.
Yeah, exactly.
This is not breaking news.
They will know for sure. So
in whatever town they're in,
it doesn't matter. Exactly. So I'm in Montreal, Canada still, and we ran out of marijuana. So I call a friend, and of course he has marijuana. He says to me, hey, I'll bake it in a cake for you and bring it over. And I said, cool, because I never had it in a cake before. So he baked it, was a chocolate cake. And he filled it with so much marijuana, which I found out now after the fact. But at that time, I didn't know, but he must have poured the kitchen sink in that thing. But so he brought the cake over, left it, and he left me and my girlfriend there. So I cut my girlfriend a piece and I cut me a piece. We ate a piece and 10 minutes went by, nothing happened. I said, I think we probably got to eat a little bit more, you know, because it takes maybe, you know, maybe he didn't put a lot in there and we have to, that's why we don't feel anything. So we took another piece, she took another piece. Actually, no, she took half and I took half because we wanted to get high. So she took half and I took half. And 10 minutes went by again, nothing. I said, must be a bad batch or something. You don't feel anything? No. I said, me neither. Then another 10 minutes went by. Then we start feeling something. And what we were feeling was not necessarily that we were getting high, but more like our bodies were shutting down. First, like I would be talking with her and I would forget to breathe, you know? And then it started to be a little bit hard for me to move. And my girlfriend said, hey, you better call 911 or something because while we still can, while you still can. I said, yeah, you're right. And I it was hard for me and I dialed 911 and then they said, how can we help you? And this was the embarrassing part. Because we had to tell them, you know, well, you know, we had too much, maybe too much marijuana and a cake. And we feel like, can you come and help us? We feel like we're dying here, you know. And they said, okay, we'll be right on. We'll be on our way. Now, when you call them about any narcotics, they also call the police. So the police came with them. But we had ate all the cakes, so there was nothing, nothing to charge us with. So they left, the cops left, and took us in a stretcher. Now, this was at 4 o'clock in the morning. We were on the third floor on a stairwell case, and we were taken in stretchers, each separate stretchers. 4 o'clock, lights are flashing. Mm-hmm. Neighbors looking out the window like this as we're coming down the stairs in front of their mm-hmm. window. Mm-hmm. What happened to them? Mm-hmm. You know, and it looks like a scene out of Mick Jagger, David Bowie overdosing or something. It just looks wild, man. So they put us in the ambulance and we're in the ambulance and they're rushing. I'm happy that they arrived because I was like, when they arrived, I was really holding on to dear life because I knew that I didn't have much time. Because my heart was trying to beat and everything was coming stiff. I couldn't move. And I believe it's because he put so much and it went directly in my bloodstream and started to paralyze. Instead of just getting high, it started to paralyze the system. Anyway, we got to the hospital and another strange thing happened was when we got to the hospital, at the reception, I saw my dead mother again. She was standing at the reception, looking through papers. She had this shirt on that she wears. She had a women's club. Mm-hmm. And they would, like 10 women, they would go play bingo. They would go to trips. And they would wear these particular shirts, you know. And she had that on. And she was looking through the, and I said, as they were rolling me past the reception, I said, that's strange, there's mom. Now, later on, as I put two and two together, I was so close to death at the time when they rolled me in, that's why I was able to see her. Mm. As clear as I see you standing right now.
Wow.
And so they rolled us in, they put me in one room, they put my girlfriend in another room, and they gave me this black drink to drink. I thought it was tar, but charcoal. Later on I found out it was charcoal.
Yeah.
So they left me in the room, gave me this drink, and I'm on the bed, hospital bed, and I'm saying, thank God they finally found me. I'm going to be all right. I'm going to live. And so I drink the drink down. Tastes horrible, man. Ugh. I drink the drink down, and I lay back, and I'm saying, whew, I'm going to be okay. I'm going to be alive. And as I relax back on the bed, I start to hear my heart in my ear. It's like somebody put my heart in my ear. Mm-hmm. And I start to hear it beat, boom, 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 boom. And when it did that, I popped out of my body. I just popped out, like as if I would just jump off the couch here. Mm-hmm. I popped out of my body. And the first thing I said then, I said, I'm out. And my body was in the bed and I was standing beside it. And then I looked at my hand. I was looking at my hand. And the way to describe that was, I describe it like if you watch television too late and those emergency broadcasting system comes on and you have all that static. And if you look in the static, you can see colors. If you look really hard, it's not just gray. Mm-hmm. And when I looked at my hand, it was like a gray with a light blue tint all around it. And I was just looking at it like that. And then across from my bed was a sink. And in the sink, there was a drop of water dropping. And for some odd reason, when I was out of my body, my curiosity was like at 1,000%. And to a soul, a drop of water was amazing. And I said, wow, a drop of water. I said, I would like to see that water up close. And the minute I thought it, my vision went directly up close and back again to where I was. And then here's the other part. Then I said to myself, I'd like to see. No, then I said, I would like to stop this drop of water and to stop time so that I can see it, because it was called bup, bup. And it was as if you don't ride a bicycle in 20 years and I give you a bike, you're still going to be able to ride it. Mm-hmm. It was like that for me. It was like I was remembering, and I just waved my hand across the air and the drop of water froze in midair. I stopped time. Mm-hmm. And for some odd reason, the soul or me, wasn't so surprising, mm-hmm. you know. And then I said, I'd like to see that drop of water from every angle. And then I just opened my hand and five of me appeared at the sink, at the drop of water. One was on the right, one was on the left, one was underneath the water looking, one was watching them, and I was watching all of them. Mm. And I was looking, I said, wow, this is amazing. And when I would close my hand, they would all suck back to me. Okay. Then I would open my hand, then they all be back. And it started to be funny. I started to do that. And then I said, this time I'm going to add a little shake. And I went, and they all appeared and they all shook like that a little bit. And I just kept going back and forth, and it's basically turning into Bugs Bunny, man.
Sure,
it was like Bugs Bunny, man. I was going back and forth. Oh my God, this is funny. Until I burst out laughing. When I burst out laughing on the other side, it was like I was laughing in the Grand Canyon. It just went, ha, 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 ha. And it went into eternity.
Echoing, yeah.
Yes. And then after the laugh, I felt somebody was watching me, and I heard a voice, and this voice said, kind of like a parent would say to a child at a playground, don't run around the corner too fast, you might fall. It said to me, if you don't go back now, you might have to stay. And I said, oh yeah, that's right, my heart, it can't stay stopped like that too much longer. I said, yeah, that's right, you're right. And I didn't question who was talking to me. I felt like it was probably God, mm-hmm. but it was gentle. It was not saying you must go back. It was almost like a choice. If you don't go back now, you might have to stay. Mm. And it was now up to me to make that choice if I wanted to go to stay or to go back. But I mean, I was, you know, a young man, 34, 35, I wanted to go back. So I pointed myself in the direction of the body. Now, the interesting thing was that I never wanted to look at my body, man.
Really?
Because I only saw my leg, but I didn't want to look at the whole body because I was afraid I was going to have some facial, mm-hmm. you know, look of death And I didn't want to be scared. So I never looked, only saw my leg, and I knew I was standing on the side of the bed, and my body was there because I could see my leg. But I didn't want to look. So I pointed myself in the direction of the body, and then I just willed my soul to go into it, and it went into it, and my heart started to beat, and it just did a double boom, boom, and it started to beat. And then that was it. But there was something else. So yeah, I have to mention that. As I was out of my body, this was another thing that was happening all the time. It's like, I don't know if you have Alka-Seltzer. You know Alka-Seltzer. Mm-hmm. You put Alka-Seltzer into water and it's dissolving, right?
Mm-hmm.
When I was outside of my body, information was expanding like that.
Mm.
And I got a lot of what we can call downloads or information about everything, about the earth, about why souls come, many things, and that I didn't believe in before. And it blew my mind, but I got all that information. And this time I was able to bring it back. This time I was able to remember it. And yeah, and then my heart started beating, everything was okay, but I knew a lot of things that I didn't know before.
Like what?
Oh, for example, on the other side, there's no right or wrong, only perception. The reason why souls come here is to experience, not to grow or not to go to a school. They're already perfect. They come here to experience. If I give you a book to read on how to drive a car, but you've never driven a car, you know, it's like that. You have the knowledge, but you don't have the experience. Stuff like, the Bible. The Bible, there's only some things that are correct in the Bible. The rest is manipulation from the priests and the governments that wrote that was controlling the people at the time.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing, Christ. Christ is like, there's a Christ consciousness. Just under unconditional love, it's a consciousness, but it's not. It's we all are sons or gods. Oh, yeah, here's the other thing. We are gods with a big G. We're part of God, but we also are gods. We can have multiple lifetimes at the same time. We can, there's so many things that we can do, and we only use a fraction of our power to have a lifetime like we're having now. I learned so much about here's another one about hell. Why people experience hell, some of them, when they die, because what they believed in, because they're such powerful gods, what they believed in, they actually created. Now, according to the Christian religion, if you die and you go to hell, you're never supposed to get out, right?
Right.
Why are hundreds are getting out? Why? Because they created that. God is only love, only. And will never torture you. Here's another one. No karma. There's no such thing as karma. Karma is no, it's not such thing. But there is a such thing as law of attraction, frequency. And that means if you kill somebody, it's not because you killed that person that you're going to be killed. It's because you're on that frequency of the possibility of you being killed. It happening, you killing or being killed. It's like a radio station. If you have rock, you can't get classical music because you're on the frequency of rock. And the same with killing or lying. If you're on the frequency of killing, you're on that frequency. So you may kill, but you also may be killed because you're on that killing frequency. And that's what it's about. It's not about, oh, you get paid back. Oh, you got to get, no. There's no debt with that.
Mm-hmm.
Many things. Yeah. I learned a lot of many things, and it's very important. And people have different death experiences because of the process of when they die, where their mind and heart is at that moment.
Right.
And also learned that, even from my mother, she needed an escort to come back to Earth because it takes time for different souls to get used to the other side. Everything isn't quite automatic. It goes slowly and slowly and slowly in a comfortable way that's comfortable for the individual. So that's why you may see comfortable things. A guy who's into Buddha, Krishna, they may see Buddha. A guy who's into Muslim may see Allah. It's to make you comfortable.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay. That's what I've heard.
But the true religion is love. It has nothing to do with it. And there's no, forget about all that sin and all that stuff. That's junk. Mm. A baby has done nothing wrong. It's not a sinner.
Yeah, I've had that conversation before.
Okay.
About my own kids.
The relatives
are like, so you're not going to baptize? I'm like, why? Because they have a sin. This baby has a sin. And if I don't do it, they're no matter what they do in life, they're going to this place called hell. And they're like, well, when you say it like that, well, that's how you're saying it.
Exactly. Like, that's exactly how you say it.
It makes no sense. It makes no sense.
Right. It's almost a threat to life, you know? Right. So anyway, I learned a lot. And also, I got a gift from that.
Yeah. What was it? What'd you get back?
Well, it's something I discovered by accident, actually, because after I died and came back and that was over, I wanted to go back on my life. Let's try to be a little bit normal. Let's go back to life. And I was in a club in Canada, Montreux, it's called. That's like north of Canada. And there was a snowstorm and my band was there and hardly nobody was there. And there was two waitresses. Now, I had never played this particular club before. It was a new club. So we were happy. Hey, we got a new gig, new club. And but there was nobody because we were snowed out. And so we were having our beers. And there was a waitress. And I said, come here, waitress. For fun, I'm going to tell you your future. It was supposed to be a joke. I grabbed her. I said, give me your left hand. And I took her hand just for fun. And I said, your boyfriend is paraplegic. I said, he blames you for his handicap. I said, you're going to meet a guy 3 months from now and you're going to fall in love and you're going to marry him. And you're going to live happily ever after with that person. And then I just left her, threw their hand and left her. I didn't pay attention that she didn't say anything through the whole thing I was talking. Mm-hmm. And I just finished my beer. A year later, we played the same club. This girl ran up to me and said, hey, do you know everything you said was true? I said, no way. Impossible. I said, your boyfriend was paraplegic? She said, yes. I said, he blamed you for his handicap, even though it was your fault? She said, yes. I said, 3 months after you met another guy? She said, yes. I said, you fell in love and you got married to him? And then she showed me the wedding ring. And then the bumps went up my arm, man. And the band looked at me and like, what's happening to you, man? Are you turning into Nostradamus? What's going on? And I became afraid because I said, what happened? Am I alien now? What is this?
You know what's really interesting? Because I mean, you're in the music business, I'm in the film industry. I've dabbled in the music business. I know the people in the and I've done music videos and stuff. I've lived in that world. Right. So artists in general, fairly open-minded, generally speaking.
Yeah.
But even artists have, especially in the music business, you start freaking people out real quick. And you're a working musician who could easily just be like, nah, he's crazy. I don't want to work with him. Or he's like, he's spooky.
Exactly.
He's spooky. I don't want to work
spooky.
With him.
That's the, he's spooky. Exactly.
So how did you psychologically deal with, well, first of all, before we even get to that, when this near-death experience happened, how did you psychologically deal with it? And then when did you decide to come out of the closet, if you will, the spiritual closet and the closet to tell people, look, man, this is what's kind of happened in me.
Well, the thing is, I kept it for a long time. I said, man, if I tell them this, they're just going to think he's cuckoo. You know, they're just not going to, you know. But the thing was, is that it came to a point where I said, you know, you got to be you. I said, this happened for a reason. I said, and also, who cares what anybody thinks anymore? You know, what what is good is that going to do you if they all, oh, they either they like you or they don't. You're a nice person. So if they don't like you, that's their problem, man. Or they think you're crazy, that's their problem. You know what happened to you. Just tell the people, because it's going to help them, because the information you got can help so many people, can help people not be afraid of death. It can help people to understand that they're not paying some karma tab. It's just frequency. Get on a positive frequency. Stay away from the negative frequency, and you'll watch your life get better. Mm-hmm. So it's not, you know, so I struggled with that for about 2 years, and then I said, that's it. And Jeff Mora, I was watching a program, because I usually don't even watch about NDEs. I don't even watch it, because it would remind me of what happened to me, and hey, why are you not talking about it? Mm-hmm. You know. So I was watching Jeff Mora, and this was this girl that was on, and she had did some kind of ayahuasca trip.
Mm-hmm.
And she looked cute. So I said, oh, she's pretty. Let me check this out, see what's going on with her. And she was telling about her trip, and some of her things she was saying reminded me of my experience.
Mm-hmm.
And then I wrote Jeff, and I said, hey, Jeff, that was a great interview. I said, that sounds like some experience that I had, similar, you know. And he said, well, why don't you come on and tell your experience? And I was shocked, because I never thought, I mean, the guy has so many followers, I never thought he would ask me. And so he asked me, and then that's when I started. And I felt liberated, because when you have a story like that, man, it's like a deep, dark secret.
Oh, yeah. Keeping.
And you carry that burden around, and it's like, you know something, but you're not telling. And because you're afraid of what people think, man, forget about it. Don't care about what people think. So I came out with it. And after that, my interviews went crazy, and I've been doing interviews all the time and helping people. But to get back to the gift, I had some ups and downs with that. One down part, which was a big question, was one time after that incident with the waitress, we had a friend. We used to, after our shows, we'd go to after hours.
Yeah.
We call it, those are places that stay open after the clubs close.
Yeah. The after party of the after party.
Yes. 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 And this guy, he was a bouncer, but he was a cool people. He was a friend of mine and a friend of the band. He was cool, come to our shows, you know, cool people. One weekend, I had a premonition that, for him not to go out this weekend. I had it on Thursday. Mm-hmm. And I said, yeah. And I mean, it was so strong. It stayed like a cloud for the whole day over me. And I said, yeah, but if I tell him not to go out for this weekend, stay home, he's going to think I'm crazy.
Mm-hmm.
I said, I mean, the guy is a huge guy. He's strong. He take care of himself. He's not, stay home. Don't go out, stay in your apartment, don't go out for the weekend. He's going to think I'm nuts.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't tell him. And I saw him on that Friday. Everything was cool. And I said, you know, maybe it's me, you know, maybe I'm just sensitive, all this stuff going on. Maybe you just imagine that feeling. So Friday, I saw him, everything was cool. I wanted to tell him, but I said, nah, I don't want him to think I'm crazy, so I won't tell him. So then Sunday came. I came to the same place, same after hours after my show, except the bouncer wasn't there. It was another bouncer there. And he was at the door with tears rolling down his face. And I said, hey, man, what's wrong? What's going on? He said, you didn't hear?
No.
I said, hear what? You know, the bouncer's dead. I said, dead? I said, what happened? He said, Saturday he met this girl, and he took her to, after his job, that's finished at, I don't know, 6 or 7 in the morning, he took her to a hotel. She waited till he fell asleep, and he slashed his throat. he lost so much blood that he could not fight back because he was sleeping and she just went at it. And by the time he realized what she was doing, he lost consciousness. And yeah, and when that happened, when he told me that, it just blew my mind. I felt so guilty because I said to myself, and I went to his funeral, and I said to myself, never again am I going to hide any psychic impressions that I get, even if it's the president of the United States. Mm-hmm. And I said, I'm going to tell them. I don't care if they think I'm crazy or whatever. I'm going to tell them. Lisa's not going to be on. But later on, I found out, like from my soul point of view, was that he might not have listened to me anyway, even if I had told him.
Sure.
So not for me to take it in such a guilty way.
Yeah, like it's not your fault. It's not your fault. Right.
So everybody in the life, here's another download. Everybody in the life has exit points. Mm-hmm. Now, exit points in your life is like the time you had a coffee instead of going to work on time and you missed an accident, or you didn't catch that plane and that plane crashed. Mm-hmm. Stuff like that. Or you didn't walk across the red light because you were on the phone and you had to talk and you didn't cross, and this car would have hit you if you had mm-hmm. to cross because he ran the light. You know, those are exit points. And we all have exit points to if we want to stay or we want to leave. Here's the other thing. We take this life too serious, because this life is a game. It's created by souls for souls to experience in. And the earth is a soul. It's alive. That's why if you put something in the ground, if you plant something in the ground, it grows, because this life, it's not just a rock. Mm-hmm. And it's actually a soul. And I'll give you a little bit of what's going on now with this, because we're experiencing a vibrational change, mm-hmm. a complete vibrational change. And what the earth is doing is offering everybody a choice, because there's going to be two timelines. There's going to be a 5D timeline and a 3D timeline. And it doesn't matter which choice you take, because mm-hmm. I mean, God loves you anyway. And here's the other thing, maybe your viewers, this would help some of your viewers, is that nobody dies a horrible death. Mm. Now, I'm going to tell you why, because seconds or even minutes, sometimes even 10 minutes before you're going to check out of here, your soul is out of your body before it happens. So you won't experience the murder. You won't experience the knife or the bullet going in your head. You won't experience that.
How about long-term, like pain, like a disease?
Well, long-term disease, depending on how much how much pain it is, because if it gets to a certain level, your soul leaves the body anyway. It'll leave. You won't be experiencing that. You can experience some pain, yes, excruciating too, but not for too long periods of time, because after a while, your soul won't deal with that. It'll leave. Mm. So you'll be the body might be experienced, but you won't be feeling that at all. So that's why you don't feel like a child is murdered or whatever. You can even hear people say, I was not there when it actually happened.
No, I've heard that multiple times from near-death experiencers, they don't feel that
aspect. Or a car accident seconds before the car impacts.
Oh yeah.
They're not there. They don't even remember the impact.
Right. That does, because I've heard that multiple times.
Yeah, but that's what I got my downloads, because you're taken out. Your soul is taken out before.
So Dennis, let me ask you this.
Yes.
When you finally decided to come out of the NDE closet and the spiritual closet, as you have, how did your colleagues and your career deal with it? Was it business as usual?
How did it work? That's a good question. Well, the thing is, I started to do readings for people, and I do that now. I read energy. I help people with health. I help people with relationships, sometimes cheating wives and cheating husbands. Because your energy has all I do is read the energy. The answers are in you. So I read your energy, what your energy says to me. And mm-hmm. I just repeat back to you what it says to me. That's all. And so, yeah, well, it made me, I go for my music now in a different way, because before it was just only ambition. You know, I have to be with the best, the top, the bup. I've got to do this. They've got to love me. I've got to practice. I've got to. Mm-hmm. It was like that. Instead of doing it, now I do it more out of love, out of just, I enjoy it. And I hope you enjoying it. And I'm hoping I'm giving you love for my music that is changing your day or change, making you feel better for that moment that you're listening to my show.
Mm. And you have worked with some interesting people in your life.
Oh, yes. Oh, quite. But you know what's funny Quincy Jones taught me a lot. And because I was, when I first met him, I was in awe. I was like, this Michael Jackson's producer.
He's also a sax player.
Yeah, exactly. So I was freaked out. And when I first met him, I said something really stupid. I said, hi, Mr. Jones. You know, you made my life. And you know what he said to me? He says, and you made my life too. And he said it to say that I'm no better or different than you. So don't treat me like a god. He said, I'm just like a normal guy, just like you.
Yeah.
And he said exactly what I said back to me, if, in order for me to hear how I sound like, you know, you made my life. Oh, man. So he said, you made my life. And hearing that from Quincy Jones, I'm like, oh, my God.
Yeah, you know? Of course.
He taught me that nobody's better than anybody. Don't treat anybody better. Just treat them nice, but don't treat them any better. I said, we're all human beings. And I sat with Quincy for 3-4 hours and we talked, and he had a woman bodyguard and he was something. But I learned a lot from him. And then after that, I was able to meet like more of the stars in a more calm way.
Right. You
know? But it was hard for me because Michael Jackson was like serious hero. People don't realize that in the 80s, Michael Jackson was ruling, he could have been president. Even the president had to meet him to make sure he wasn't going to run for president.
There was the three Michaels of the 80s and 90s. There was Michael Jackson, Michael Jordan, Mike Tyson. And right. Those are the three most powerful and most famous human beings on the planet.
You
can be in Zimbabwe somewhere and Mike Tyson shows up today, and everyone's gonna go, Mike Tyson. Like, it just,
yep, yeah, exactly.
Michael Jordan, like, it's it, and Michael exactly. Jackson, and they know, yeah, Michael Jackson. So yeah, yeah, and yeah, it's, I grew up in the 80s. I remember I was in New York when Beat It hit, and yeah, when I'm Thriller trying
to
tell hit.
You, they had to understand Michael Jackson would come onto the stage, man, and just stand there for about 5 minutes and people would pass out. Girls were passing out. Listen, man, I never seen an artist that happened to. Maybe Elvis, maybe. But
Beatles, the Beatles too. The Beatles.
Yeah, but not many. Not many.
No, there's not many. It was a very interesting time to be alive. I was a kid when he was coming up. I was a fan, obviously. But people can't comprehend how popular and how famous Michael was in the 80s.
Exactly.
Because it's hard to understand that there was just nothing. The competition for eyeballs and attention. We had three channels on the television. You know, right. We had one or two radio stations.
Right.
You know, exactly. It wasn't the world that we live in today. Someone like Michael today would probably be popular, but they wouldn't control the world. I mean, and
right.
Sell,
Michael ruled the world, man. I mean, even like, the princess of England had to meet him.
Because, it was just it's like you look at someone like Taylor Swift today or Beyonce, and they're massive stars.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yes.
But they don't own every piece of media all the time for like years at a time. That's what Michael was. Like,
yeah,
there
exactly.
wasn't a week that wouldn't go by without someone talking about Michael Jackson. It was crazy.
Oh, forget it. So, you know, so but anyway, to have his producer in my presence, I was like, oh, you know, because I'm a kid of the 80s. So I'm like, oh, Oh, you know, it was hard for me not to be, you know,
No, in
starstruck.
awe. Oh, no, yeah,
Yeah, and
true.
all, yeah. So, but Quincy brought me back down to human level. And after that, that was a big lesson for me, and I appreciate it, you know.
So, Dennis, what is the biggest takeaway you had from your near-death experience?
Ooh, that's a big, good question. Well, there's one is that love is the key to all the power, no matter what's in front of you. And the other is that we are so powerful, but we're kind of brainwashed from the beginning of life to believe otherwise, but it's not true. We are super powerful. This is the take, because many times in my life I felt so, you know, helpless or powerless and all this, and it's not true. It's just we have to control what we're thinking and what vibrations we surround ourselves with. We surround ourselves with, you know, it's important. And it's funny, it's so simple. You know, it sounds so cliche. Oh, just be happy. You know, it sounds so funny, but guess what? That's true. And guess what? That's more powerful than you ever know. You know, I have to mention my grandfather used to would say to me, you know, go when I was a kid, how many mistakes did you make today in school? And I said, well, today I made no mistakes. And he would be disappointed. And he asked me again the next week, how many mistakes did you make today? And I said, well, I did make one in algebra. Then he'd take me out for ice cream. And he did that for me to not be afraid to make mistakes and not to be afraid to try. So
Very important lesson in life.
that taught me a lot. And that's why, you know, when I was 18, 19, I went on a world tour because I had to try. I was in competition with about 100 adult professionals, and I was in high school, and I had won the audition, and I went on tour with the Stylistics, you know, around the world. And I never had done that before, but that was for my grandfather also saying, you can just try. And so,
I'm
you know.
gonna, so Dennis, I'm gonna ask you a few questions, ask all my guests. What is your definition of living a fulfilled life?
I would say happiness, being happy and sharing love with others. That's if you're able to be happy and share love with people, for me, you're rich, you've won.
If you can jump into a time machine and go back in time, what would you tell the little boy that used to be
Oh, very good one.
you?
Well, I would tell him, you don't have to follow anybody to be successful in music. Always believe in yourself a little bit more, no matter what anybody tells you. And don't forget to love yourself and love others. That's all. That was it.
How do you define God?
What I got in my downloads is that God is everything, and the description is almost indescribable. Is everything, you know, even the bad people we think are bad, it's all part of God, and it all has a plan also. That's another thing. Some of the bad things that happen in your life is a plan, and if you look back on it, you know, you'll see. Like my father, he was he didn't want me to do music, but he would come home after work on the police force and play the greatest jazz you ever want to hear. And that made me interested enough to become a musician. But he didn't want me to be a musician. He wanted me to be a lawyer. But I did my music. And my father didn't support me on that. And because he didn't support me, it made me want to work harder to be a great artist.
He played his part.
You see? Exactly.
He played his
Exactly.
part. He played his
You know?
part.
Yeah.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
Experience. And also remembering who you really are, you really love. That's it.
And where can people find out more about you and the work that you're doing, sir?
Well, they can reach me for energy readings or session at my email, easybullock@hotmail.com. I hope you can put it in your description box
Sure,
so
sure,
people
sure.
can reach me there. and they can write me with anything. I mean, I help people with suicides. I help stop that. I help people with illness. I help people with personal problems, anything they want to know about. Because when I read energy, anybody you hate and anybody you love, you're connected to. Your energy is connected to them. Mm-hmm. It's more harder for me to read a person that you have no connection with. You see, I can do it, but it's harder. But with somebody you love or somebody you hate, you're connected. Your energy is connected to them. Yeah.
And do you have any parting messages for the audience, my friend?
Yes. We're going through an energy change on the planet. You have a choice. Rather you go positive, high vibrations, or negative, low vibrations. Low vibrations will leave you in 3D, third dimension. And we're going to change in the next coming times, years, we're going to change. It's going to switch. So I would say if you want a world of just love and peace and harmony with everything and everyone, you might want to go to 5D. If you don't, it's okay. I don't hate anyone who likes the roller coaster ride. Then you stay on the lower vibrations. But don't be confused with all this confusion, because the confusion, why it's affecting everybody on the planet, is because of vibrational change. The earth is rising. It's not getting worse like people think. It's actually getting better. There's more light coming in. But the people who are in low vibration are having a harder time, because you can't put a positive battery and a negative battery together for a long time. What happens? Mm-hmm. They try to split apart, and that's what's happening right now.
Mm-hmm. Very true, my friend. Thank you, Dennis, so much for coming on the show and sharing your story, your journey with us, and spreading the good love and energy that you are in the world, my friend. I appreciate you.
Hey, I appreciate you, Alex, and I'm a big fan of your work now. And I also hope you continue to open the doors of mystery to life, and that people can benefit from those mysteries, and that they will feel more knowledge of a positive nature to deal with the life we live in every day.
Appreciate mm-hmm. you, my friend. Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.